Good morning, everybody. You're very welcome to our morning worship service. Just as people are still coming in, we're going to get through a few announcements. There's quite a few to go through. But I want to thank Ryan for stepping in last week. We were away for a quick break up the North Coast, so it was good. I have 3 cups of coffee already this morning, so the service may be a lot quicker than normal. If you're visiting with us for the first time, you are very welcome. After the service, there's tea and coffee and treats down in the hall. So don't just go and jump into your car and head off. You can head to the hall. Who's still got a snowman in the garden? Anybody? Yeah, we've still got Jude. We've still got the remnants of a rabbit still in our garden. So everything else is gone, but that's still there. But anyway, that's where we're at with that. So most of the announcements, everything is running as normal this week, except for tomorrow night at 7 p.m. is Easter Vestry here in church. That's our AGM, basically, where we come along and we look at the year that has passed, 2022. And if you're on the general vestry, you'll be allowed to vote on anything that is happening. So if you like an AGM, you're very welcome to come along and join with us. Our AGMs aren't really that long, so if you wish, there'll be a wee bit of information tomorrow night as well about what's happening in the year ahead. Now, on Tuesday night, we're excited about this. We are starting our men's group. Our men's group is meeting in the rectory at 7:30. If you don't know where it is and you want to come along, please speak to me afterwards. Basically, it's for us guys, no matter what age we are, we're going to gather. We're going to have a bit of crack. There may even be pizza, so don't eat too much at home when you come along. And we're going to talk about the future and the things that we're going to do. Now, the ladies were there last week, okay? And I had to beat a retreat upstairs, but they were very noisy. I was trying to be holy and have a quiet time, and all the girls cackling and laughing. So guys, you have a lot to live up to. So please, if you want, please come and join with us. It's not going to be a big, heavy Bible study, but it's just a time for us to get together, to know each other a wee bit more, and just to have a bit of crack as well. And it's going to be every other week, and then we're going to have a couple of outings as well. So please come along and join with us at the rectory. Parking at the rectory will be in the field and also on the hard shoulder. I say nothing about the ladies' parking last week. Well, I might, but if you pay me well enough, I'll say nothing. Okay, so that's that. That's happening. Prayer ministry training is Saturday the 25th of March in Drumbeg. We have a number of names already for that. If you want to be part of the prayer ministry team, please speak to me and we'll do that. Daffodil tea, Saturday the 1st of April. There's not many tickets left, but I think they want to gather in the money and stuff like that, so you can speak to Sandra or Agnes here this morning. And if you want a ticket, it is by ticket only. You can't just turn up on the day. You need your tickets to be able to come along to that. But that's Saturday, the 1st of April at 2 o'clock through to 4:30. Now, can I just say this? Tomorrow, or next Saturday, again, at Drumbeg Hall, they're doing stew. If you know anybody in the community, or you just want to go and have a free meal and a bit of chat, up to Drumbeg Orange Hall next Saturday as well. Now also, they're having an over 80s gathering and birthday celebration for Maud. She's well over 80, but she hasn't said anything. She must be quiet or didn't hear me. But back row, have you got your hearing aids all on? Brilliant. Okay. So they're having an over 80s bash. It's not Saturday the 1st of April. What date was it? 25th of March. I've got that wrong, but it's a Saturday before that. So please speak to Joan or Sarah or Marilyn if you want to go along to that as well. Also, the Ballyvesque Old Boys, the little band hall opposite Cameron's Garden Centre, there's a Beetle Drive on Saturday night as well. I'll sit about that, do that. Now next week is Mother and Sunday, so church is normal, 9:30, 11 o'clock. We're going to do a wee bit at the start for mums, and then boys and girls and everybody will be out for their Genesis and Sunday school as well. I think that is most of the announcements. Yeah, okay. If I've forgotten anything, please wave. Okay, I do apologise, a wee bit longer this morning. Select Vestry, we're meeting very quickly afterwards in the little room. Grab yourself a cup of coffee, chat, and we hope to meet in there just for a few minutes in the little room off the hall after this morning's service. Don't worry, don't quieten them, they're fine. I get through this first bit quickly and then you can go out to Christ. Isn't that easier? Isn't that a good job? Yeah. It's amazing when you promise people you can leave. People are happier. Okay. One other, it's a sad announcement. Most of you will know that at the start of the week on Sunday, we've been praying for Jenny. Jenny Dunlop would have been coming to church occasionally here. And she just lived in a little house there just at the corner of Fort Road. It's a wee bit just the offshoot of Fort Road. And Jenny was involved in a car accident last Sunday night. So sadly, Jenny passed away. Her funeral is tomorrow at 2 p.m. in Stranmillis Evangelical Presbyterian Church. And then she is coming here to be laid to rest with her father. So that's tomorrow. If you're about the family, they're having refreshments in the hall. They would love to see you. So please bear that in mind tomorrow. We're going to take a moment of silence, maybe, and begin with this prayer for today. Merciful Lord, grant your people grace to withstand the temptations of the world, the flesh and the devil, and with pure hearts and minds to follow you, the only God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We're going to stand to begin with our greeting, and then we're going to sing Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. Will you please stand? The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
You just have to realize, the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Amen. We're going to sing Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. First time through his son Jesus. And so we're going to take a wee moment Think about our own lives. Think of perhaps the things that we have done wrong and that we're going to come before God to receive his forgiveness. And so we pray together, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault, by what we have done and by what we have failed to do. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that's past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. And Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy on you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Now, just before the boys and girls go out and the young people go out for their morning together, I want to talk very quickly about something that is happening later this week, okay? And can any of the boys and girls tell me what is happening on Friday? No? Liam?
St. Patrick's Day.
Yes, it's St. Patrick's Day, but it's also the day Campbell College are going to be Ince. Sorry, I do apologise. Look at all those lovely faces smiling back at me. But, yes, it is St. Patrick's Day, and it's a day when we, as a country, celebrate Christianity really coming to Ireland, and we celebrate Patrick, who brought the good news to this land. And, boys and girls, who's off? Somebody's got a half day. Anybody off all day? Okay. And if you really want, there is a great pilgrimage. There's buses from Downpatrick Cathedral in the morning. I think the last bus leaves at 8:30. We'll take you out to Saul. And Saul is where Patrick's first church is. And then you go to a nice church service there. You have a cup of coffee. And then you can walk back into Downpatrick. It's a great pilgrimage. If you haven't done it before, I'm sticking to the mums and dads as well. I encourage you to do it. I would be doing it, but I got a marriage preparation class to do that morning, so I can't, not for ourselves, we're okay, Rosemary and I, but at the minute, but just for another lovely couple who are home for this weekend. So Friday's the only time I can see them, but I know there's a few people from church going, and if you want directions or you want to know what's happening, please do that. You come back into Downpatrick Cathedral, there's another service there and a free packed lunch. The Bishop of Rwanda's coming to talk about reconciliation, and then they're laying a wreath at St. Patrick's grave. But boys and girls, before you go out, I'm going to show you this little video about who St. Patrick really was. Can anybody tell me, where do you think he was from? Shout out. What? Wales, okay. Did okay at the rugby yesterday? Anybody from England here this morning? We got sore yesterday, wasn't it? I do apologise. But anyway, we're going to watch this little video, and then we're going to pray, and then the boys and girls can head out for their morning session together. Hopefully you hear it all right.
On March 17th of each year, it's the season for shamrocks, leprechauns, green beer, pinching people who forget to wear green. It's St. Patrick's Day. That's the day we celebrate the Irish saint who somehow convinced all the snakes in Ireland to pack their bags and move to England. Except that no snakes ever lived in Ireland in the first place, so Patrick couldn't have sent them anywhere. And Patrick wasn't Irish at all, he was British, and no church has ever officially named Patrick a saint. So if St. Paddy's Day isn't about an Irish saint with a knack for sending snakes to England, what are we celebrating on March 17th? Now, the true story of Patrick begins in the 4th century. He was born about the time that Christianity became the official religion of the Roman Empire. His dad was a deacon, his granddad was a pastor. But Patrick had no interest in Christianity. But when he was 16, everything in his life suddenly changed. Irish pirates were raiding along the western coast of Britain, and they took him as their prisoner. So Patrick ended up as a slave on a sheep ranch in Ireland. His slave master was a druid priest and a clan chieftain. During those years of slavery, God transformed his heart. Now, after 6 years of slavery, Patrick had a dream that he should try to escape, and he did. He fled to Britain and he became a monk, and then 20 years after he escaped from Ireland, God called him to go back, proclaimed the gospel to his former captors. Now Patrick knew how the Irish people spoke, he knew how they fought, he knew how they ruled. So he spoke the gospel first to the chieftains of each clan. And one of the first people to embrace the message of Jesus was Milchu, the man who for 6 years had been Patrick's slave master. Now, according to later tradition, he used the three-leaf shamrock to explain the Trinity to the Irish. Just as the shamrock is one single clover with three leaves, God is one God with three persons. Now, there's no clear evidence that this really happened, but the Irish did see the shamrock as a sacred symbol, so it's possible. So it seems that Patrick died on March 17th in the year 493. Not Irish, not a snake charmer, never officially named as a saint, but a simple servant of Jesus Christ who shared God's love with the very people who had once enslaved him.
So that's who St. Patrick was. I love that last bit that actually says he was a simple servant who served God and who came to this land to bring us the good news. I'm going to pray, and then the boys and girls are going to leave us for their morning together down at the halls. Lord, we thank you for Patrick, Lord, for bringing the good news to this land. And Lord, we thank you for our boys and girls and our young people, and we pray now, Lord, that you will be with them, Lord, as they spend this time together in the halls. Amen. Boys and girls, off you go.
Sin, traveling from place to place as the Lord commanded. They camped at Rephidim, but there was no water for the people to drink. So they quarreled with Moses and said, "Give us water to drink." Moses replied, "Why do you quarrel with me? Why do you put the Lord to the test?" But the people were thirsty for water there, and they grumbled against Moses. They said, "Why did you bring us up out of Egypt to make us and our children and livestock die of thirst?" Then Moses cried out to the Lord, "What am I to do with these people? They are almost ready to stone me." The Lord answered Moses, "Go out in front of the people. Take with you some of the elders of Israel and take in your hand the staff with which you struck the Nile, and go. I will stand there before you by the rock of Hobron. Strike the rock, and water will come out of it for the people to drink." So Moses did this in the sight of the elders of Israel, and he called the place Massa and Meribah, because the Israelites quarreled and because they tested the Lord, saying, "Is the Lord among us or not?" This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Leslie, for bringing us our first Bible reading. We're going to, just in a wee moment, stand and sing a song that we've played a number of times here in church. It's "Lord, I Need You," and it's based on an old hymn, just as our first song that we sang together, "Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing," is an old hymn that has been reworked and brought back in to the worship of the church. And hopefully you know this, the words will be on the screen, so I'm just going to ask you to stand and join with us as we sing this song together. Will you please stand? Thank you. It's a wonderful song for us as a church as we think about God's need and what we need. And guess what? You're going to be really lucky because we have to have the offer for him yet, so we're going to take money off you twice this morning. He's confused me there by doing that, but anyway. It's ballet lesson. We're not perfect, so there we go. So get your collection ready for the next time. We're going to have our next Bible reading. Thank you.
The second reading is taken from John's Gospel, chapter 4. So he came to a town in Samaria called Sychar, near the plot of ground Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired as he was from the journey, sat down by the well. It was about noon. When a Samaritan woman came to draw water, Jesus said to her, "Will you give me a drink?" His disciples had already gone into the town to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "You're a Jew and I'm a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink? For Jews do not associate with Samaritans." Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water." "Sir," the woman said, "you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. Where can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did also his sons and his livestock?" Jesus answered, "Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water." He told her, "Go, call your husband and come back." "I have no husband," she replied. Jesus said to her, "You're right when you say you have no husband. The fact is, you have had five husbands, and the man you now have is not your husband. What you have just said is quite true." The woman said, "I can see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you Jews claim that the place where we must worship is in Jerusalem." "Woman," Jesus replied, "believe me, a time is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You Samaritans worship what you do not know. We worship what we do know, for salvation is from the Jews. Yet a time is coming and has now come when the true worshippers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for they are the kind of worshippers that the Father seeks. God is spirit, and his worshippers must worship in the spirit and in truth." The woman said, "I know that Messiah, called Christ, is coming. When he comes, he will explain everything to us." Then Jesus declared, "I, the one speaking to you, I am he." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. We were going to have an offertory hymn, but we've already lifted the collection, so we will maybe just give that a little skip. And Sheila, we'll save that one for next week. What do you think? Okay, well, that's what we'll do, so you can sit back and relax. So, and just, I just want to share a few short thoughts with you on the passages that we have heard. And it's actually great skipping out of him, because I can preach far longer now. Is that good? Maybe not. I had some of my family were here this morning at our 9:30 service, and in the prayer book, in the communion, it says sermon immediately after the offertory, and I told them, don't panic. I said, in case you're here and you think it's going to be 25, 30, 35, 40 minutes, that's not the case. I said, I'll save that for 11, but that's not the case. I want to share with you a few short thoughts on the passage and the passages that we have read and that have been brought to our attention this morning. And a joke was marked during the week when I said, there's a terrible long reading. The next one is very, very long. Who's reading it? They went, it's your wife. So I had to tentatively tell Rosemary it was a very, very, very long reading. And I'm still here, so that's good. I nearly wasn't here. You haven't seen the video, but I decided to try a bit of sledging during the week. And the video that's online is the one that I didn't go too far. And the next video that we took, I actually went head over bottom. There's another phrase, but I can't use that in church. That's when you shouldn't realise when you're in your mid to late 50s, you shouldn't be doing stuff like that. But anyway. So this whole idea of thirst is a theme that has run through the Bible readings today. This morning in the 9:30, we use Psalm 95. And Psalm 95 alludes to the incident in Exodus, where we see, again, the people grumbling. Imagine that. Imagine people in church grumbling. Never happens here. Sure it doesn't. Okay. None of you have got your sweets out yet. You haven't the time. See, you thought the offering was coming before that. But people grumble. Whether we like it or not, we all grumble. I grumble. I grumble a lot. But I don't grumble in front of you because I have to be very holy. But it says the people were grumbling. And the people had been brought out of slavery. That God had already provided many miracles for them. In the passage, if you go back through Exodus, you will see just before this instance where they were grumbling because they were thirsty, God had provided bread from heaven, which was called manna. And yet, now, the people were grumbling again. And we see it was to do with a physical thirst that they had obviously travelled that far, and the place that they had rested, there was no water. And so they complained. Now, I was going to ask, we live in a country here that has loads of rain and water, and perhaps we don't maybe have that same thirst that other people that experience drought would have. But I'm sure most of you here can put your hand up and testify to a time when you have been thirsty, when your mouth has been dry, and the smallest drop of water on your tongue can bring relief. A number of years ago, I actually had an experience of actually being so thirsty that I went a bit doolally, and that's what can happen. We can all go a little bit doolally when we don't get enough hydration. And probably in this room, many people have watches, smartwatches on. My watch keeps asking me how much I've drank at the end of the day. And I thought, is there a secret camera in here? I can see my wine cupboard or whiskey cupboard. But we're all about hydration. And a number of years ago, in my previous role, I applied for a job, and it involved a lot of physical exercise. And I had prepared my body. I had done, you can tell, can't you, by the shape of me? Not anymore. But I had trained and trained and trained. I had done a lot of exercises. I had got up to the running distance. I had got up to the press-ups. I had got all the other stuff that was required. And then we headed off to do this selection course. And unfortunately for me, and which is very weird in Northern Ireland, a certain bit of the province that we went to that particular day, it was 26 degrees. And I laughed because there were people dropping out during the warm-ups. So about two and a half hours into this session of you can't call it beasting anymore, I don't know what you call it, but 2.5 hours into this, I got down onto the ground to do a few more press-ups, and the ground was moving. So what did I have to start off? In Northern Ireland, it sounds strange, but heat exhaustion. And when eventually somebody picked me up and put me in the back of a car and put oxygen on me, the first thing that they made sure I did was to take on liquid, to take on, they said I hadn't. I maybe had prepared physically, my body was prepared, but one thing I missed was hydrating enough because of the weather, because of the hot day. I hadn't taken on enough liquids. So I went a wee bit doolally. And you're probably all saying, still doolally. It hasn't changed. So I understood from then the importance of taking on water. Of actually, when you are thirsty, to drink, to listen to your body. And in the future, when I was training, you learned to drink. One of the things, does anybody ever watch that thing on TV called SAS, the reality program? And the important thing that they make them do, and in my other role when we are working with Army recruits, is they always must drink a full bottle of water before they start any exercise, because they realize now the importance of hydration. This third Sunday in Lent, God is telling us about hydration. He's saying that we all thirst. The people in the wilderness were thirsty, and the promise God made to Moses, he carried out. He says, I will be with you. And he went out in front of Moses to the rock, and when he struck the rock, it says water flowed from that rock. In the New Testament passage, we see Jesus is making his way from Jerusalem to Galilee. He's heading back to the area where he did most of his ministry. And in the Holy Land, in Israel and Palestine, the route that he took to Galilee took him through what we now know today as Nablus, that sort of area where Jacob's well is, and it took him through Samaritan countryside. And the Samaritans were different to the Jews. Imagine having people in life who are different to you. Imagine having people you know that maybe go to a different church or a different denomination. But here we see the Samaritans Jesus passed through. It says he stopped at a well, and the disciples went off to the nearby town to get food. And it was at noonday, and if you've ever been somewhere really hot, they always say mad dogs and Englishmen go out in the noonday sun. They don't play rugby, but they go out in the noonday sun. Sorry, I do apologise for getting that weekend in. We'll see how it goes next week. But it's hot, and it's a hot time of the day. And while Jesus is sitting at this well, this lady comes out, and she's a Samaritan. And in this story, there is so much going on. There's so much that we can take from it. That how we deal with people who are different to us, how we deal to people who have a different outlook on their faith to us. There's so much going on in this story. But one of the things that comes from it is where Jesus offers living water. He offers this woman living water. She's slightly confused by it, but he asks her for a drink. And it is beautiful. It says Jesus is tired and he's weary. Some of the translations in the Bible say Jesus was weary. And sometimes we can glaze past that, but it shows us that Jesus was human as we are human. That his human body was weary and it was tired, but he didn't miss the opportunity to share the good news with this woman who was different. If you understand that Jewish tradition, you'll understand that firstly, Jesus spoke to this woman. Secondly, that she was a woman who wasn't of the same religion as him. And he shouldn't have been doing it, because their society, the societal rules that they had, wouldn't allow that sort of thing to happen. I love this encounter. And we see Jesus with this girl. And this is probably one of my favorite passages in the Bible. And some of you know that. And some of you know how I speak about it. Because it grieves my soul when I see division in church. It grieves my soul when I see so many denominations. Because that is not what Christ wanted for his church. He wanted one church, a worshiping church. And in this passage, I love that bit where she says about husbands. And my wife said I shouldn't say the things that I wanted to say about this girl. But she was a woman who maybe had been around a wee bit. Would you not agree with me? Mm-hmm. You've read the passage. And do you know what the beautiful thing is about this passage? There's reality to it. There's a reality to human nature in this passage. There's a rawness to it. And to be honest, when the passage has been read aloud in church, there's a cringiness to it. And we all cringe at the encounter that Jesus had with this girl. But do you know what the beautiful thing is? Jesus had the encounter with this woman. He told her, I will give you living water. Water that you will never thirst again. And we have this whole debate about who the Samaritans worship, who the Jews worship. And Jesus in here, there's a wee bit saying, like, the Jews, we've got it right. You've got it wrong. Sometimes we can miss that in this passage of scripture. But Jesus says, there's a time coming when you will worship freely. And that time is here. That time is with us. And so there's a real debate here about how we as a church and as a community move forward. Do we exclude or do we welcome? The church in the West at the minute is facing a bit of a dilemma and a bit of a crisis. Because we are perhaps trying to exclude people whenever we should be welcoming people. The country as a whole is actually getting itself into a bit of a dilemma over the migrant crisis. Do we exclude or do we welcome? And back in the day, if Jesus had a Twitter account, I would say he would be more hot water than Gary Lineker at the minute with the encounter that he had with this lady. But the reality is simply this, is that Jesus has come, and he has come for every single one of us, for every person in this church, for every person in this community, for every person in our families and in our friendship group. Jesus has come for us. Believe me, a time is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. But you will worship him in spirit and in truth. That little song that we sang by Matt Maher just a moment or two ago, there's one of the little lines in it, and it says, where sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where sin runs deep, your grace is more. Do you know what the beautiful thing is about our faith? There is endless mercy and forgiveness. I come across people all the time, and they feel sometimes they're not good enough to be a Christian. Do you know what? That's not how it works. That's not how it works. It's quite simply, we come to God as we are. We come to Jesus as we are. And he accepts us. He forgives us. One of the little verses I used this week from Isaiah, he washes us whiter than the snow. Isn't that beautiful? This woman who had many husbands, 5 husbands, and the one that she was with at the minute was not her husband. She was washed as white as the snow when she came into contact with the Messiah. And so, one word, thirst, and the invitation from God to receive this water, the spiritual water, that we will never thirst again. I want to pray, and just as I pray, if you are here this morning and you're struggling with your faith, be encouraged that Jesus is here through the power of his Holy Spirit. Be encouraged that God is with you as he was with Moses. Be encouraged that God is here and he is in us as he was in Jesus. Let us pray. Come all you who are thirsty, come to the waters. Come buy and eat. Come buy wine and milk. Why spend money on what is not bread, and your labor on what does not satisfy? Come, all you who are thirsty, come to the waters. And Lord, we just thank you for your beautiful words this morning. Lord, we thank you, Lord, that sometimes when we can be overwhelmed, Lord, with life, Lord, when we can be tired and weary, Lord, you tell us to sit and to rest and to drink. And so, Lord, we just take in, Lord, your Holy Spirit afresh this morning. Lord, we pray that you will fill every head bowed here in this church. Lord, the people, Lord, will come to you, perhaps for the first time. Lord, the people will return to you. And Lord, for those of us, Lord, who have a faith, Lord, that you will encourage us. And so, Lord, this morning, we pray, Lord, that you will help us as a church and as a community, Lord, to reach out to those around us, Lord, to those who are different from us, Lord, to those that we may disagree with, Lord, that you will give us the ability to share the good news, Lord, the news that you can give us all eternal life. And so, Lord, as we pray for that, Lord, Lord, we want to take a moment, Lord, and just pray, Lord, for those who are ill at this time. For, Lord, for those who are continuing to receive treatment for cancer. Lord, for those who are even connected to this church who are in hospital. Lord, we pray that they may know healing in their lives and in their bodies. Lord, we want to take a moment, Lord, in this church. Lord, just in the stillness and the silence and in the beauty of your presence, Lord, just to lay our own prayers and requests before you now. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, when we see the craziness in the world around us, Lord, we just pray, Lord, that you will, Lord, bless peacemakers. Lord, for the ongoing conflict, Lord, in Ukraine, Lord, in Russia, Lord, we just pray, Lord, for a breakthrough. Lord, for the ongoing crisis, Lord, in Turkey and Syria, Lord, we pray that you will continue to be with the aid agencies, Lord, Lord, that you will resource them, and Lord, that you will just be with them. Lord, we pray for this land of ours, Lord, we pray, Lord, for as we move towards Friday, Lord, as we remember our patron saint, Lord Patrick, Lord, we just pray that you will give us all, Lord, the ability to share our faith with those around us. And so, Lord, we just want to pray for those who grieve. Lord, we just pray for Jenny's family. Lord, for her children, Lord, for her sister, Lord, and brothers. Lord, we pray that they may know the comfort that can only come from you. Lord, I want to lay before you my family this morning, Lord, just, Lord, as we come to terms, Lord, with the passing, Lord, of my aunt. Lord, I just pray for my cousins Christopher and Patricia, Lord, and their family circle at this time. Lord, in your mercy. And so, Lord, we just pray for the week ahead, Lord, for our Easter vestry, Lord, tomorrow night. Lord, that as we move, Lord, and continue to move into a new year, Lord, that you will bless this church. Lord, that we'll not hold on to that blessing, Lord, but Lord, that that blessing will pour out and continue to pour out into this community. And so, Lord, we sum up our prayers in the beautiful prayer that you have taught us as we say together, Our Father. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. In just a moment, we are going to stand and sing our closing hymn, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. I did joke with Rosemary, I panicked a wee bit yesterday, because when I printed out my sermon notes, 8 pages. You're lucky I didn't stick to it, aren't you? But here's the thing, you know, go home, read this encounter again, because it's one of the most beautiful in the Bible. And just ask God to speak to you through it. And I have no doubt there are people here who are struggling at this time. And just be assured of God's presence. And be assured, I'm not saying it's cliche, they're a wee bit cheesy, but be assured of his friendship this morning as we bring this time of our worship to a close by singing What a Friend We Have in Jesus. Will you please stand?
Amen. I'm going to say morning, all right? There you go. 45 to 12.